just opened up to that. It's like a one-time thing. So take the three, two. And it's like, I'm gonna do this one better. Sometimes when the night air feels chévere, when I can hear the real sound of el barrio on la conga y timbales, coke bottles and garbage can tops, when I can feel and really, really touch la música latina, africana, and the finger-popping soul emerging from tears, sweet tears of laughter, and I can feel the conglomeration of vibrations, heat waves, body waves, people waves of real gente, and I feel good. When I can taste the rare culture of cuchifritos y lechon, chitlins and black-eyed peas and cornbread, and la pompa is open and cools the hot tar of summer-heated streets where children play, kick the can, and sirens cannot be heard. Sometimes, sometimes, when the last of the ghetto poets writes of flowers growing in gutters, and I know it's real sometimes. Sometimes when I can almost hear being echoed back an answer to my ghetto cry. Sometimes I run up the fire escape, not to escape, and climb on the roof and stand on the ledge and look down and yell out to the midnight world below, above, around, within. Oye mundo, tú eres bonito. And I forget about the junkies on the stoop. This is my fire escape. This is where I used to sit when I was a kid and look out across the street and downstairs and watch stickball games over here. I used to have a brick, one of these bricks. I could take it out and I used to keep my poetry in there when I was a little kid, dug a hole in there. When we moved, I didn't know that we were moving, so I wound up leaving some of the stuff there, including the last letter that my father wrote to me, I remember. Because we kind of moved all of a sudden. But this was my fire escape. So that's where a lot of these poems, the first poems in my book, Hey Yo, Yo Soy, are from. I would sit here, observe things, and if I didn't write about them right away, they became part of my collective memory. You know what I mean? So I could always draw from them. But I did sit here and write things, except I didn't know that they were poems when I was writing them. To me, they were just the things that I was writing when I looked out the window. And everything is translated in the book. While the poems face each other in their translation, the narratives you read completely in one language, you know, and then you get to the other language. So they first appear in English entirely, because it doesn't make any sense to have them across the page, because they might not line up like the poems do, you see? So that's just the confusing waste of time. But that you can read them uninterrupted in the language, and you can, you know, lose yourself in that. The intent here is to educate. There is no motive other than that, you see? So while I say we tried to put a book of poetry together, we wound up creating an historical document, something that should be, I gotta say this as egotistically as a 17-year-old might shout out. You need this book in your life, in your library, in the life of your library. You know, you need this book because this book will tell you and show you. Like I said, here you see a little kid turn himself into a man poet, you know, on his own, just sat on this damn fire escape. I can't help people write better, but I know I can help them think better. But we live in a society here, and probably globally, that pays more money to put a ball over a fence or in a hoop than a good idea in an impressionable mind. You know, being a poet is a real responsibility. I'm gonna tell you why it's a real responsibility. Because see, to me, the whole universe is made up of chaos. And what happened was, is anarchy came into play. And anarchy organizes chaos, whereas it's still chaos, but it's somewhat organized. Where'd it go? I'm just saying this, bro.